Britain, I know that I was enormously privileged. I was free to make choices, to be independent, to state opinions. But for many of the world's women, perhaps the majority, circumstances are very different. So in this series, I've traveled to three very different places where the roles of women are exceptional, complex, and even extreme.
Vesra.
The matrilineal Khasi people in northern India, where it's the women who take on positions of power.
You're like a very strict headmistress.
Balong in charge of traffic branch tang mga. Ka disciplinary job.
The intensely private, ultra-Orthodox Haredim in Israel, where women's lives are governed by strict religious laws. But first, I'm in Kenya, in East Africa, where women are caught right on the fault line between age-old tradition and the modern world.
How do you go and find a man? I can...
Well, it's the matter.
Is it my utaji?
Is this dangerous for you, Susan?
Ni hatari, lakini inabidi.
Driving southwest across the country, right up to the Tanzanian border. And that area is the heartland of a people known as the Kuria. They're quite a small number of people, about 500,000 altogether. Traditionally, the Kuria were cattle herding warriors. Today, they're generally agricultural crop farmers, but cattle remain important as currency, especially in marriage.
They're polygamous, so the men will marry a number of wives.
But the thing that's really fascinating is that they practice woman-to-woman marriage. So why do they do it? Is it a sexual thing? What advantages are there to a community for women to marry women? After an 8-hour drive from Kenya's capital, Nairobi, we're finally in Kuria District, home for the next 3 weeks. In its fertile hills nestle small farming communities. And it's on one of these farms that I've been invited to stay with a large extended family that practices woman-to-woman marriage.
Where Lillian lives, that's the house over there.
Okay.
And actually this is the family farm.
This one here?
Yeah, so this must be family members.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hello, Jambo!
Peter Marimi is helping us access this community. He's a journalist in Nairobi, but is Kuria and grew up here.
As you'll find out, it's really a big family.
Like, when you say a big family, how many people?
I think 20, easily.
Really?
Yeah. Hodi, mamako. Ah, jambo, abari.
Everyone looking shy.
Yeah.
The family is headed by husband Masenda.
Good to meet you.
And wife Paulina.
We are naitwa Kate.
Yeah, Kate. While Masenda has taken extra wives, what's extraordinary here is that so has his wife Paulina.
Paulina.
Hey.
Paulina.
Hey.
The tradition where women marry women is called Niom Bamboki. Paulina is married to two women.
Are you Lillian?
Yeah.
I've heard much about you.
Santi,
Santa, Santi, Santi.
Her first wife is Lillian, who's now 30 and half Paulina's age. And her second wife is 21-year-old Faith.
You can teach me everything about how this family works.
Woman-to-woman marriages exist across Africa. In this village, at least 10 of the 100 families are Niom Bamboki.
Aha, so this is the kitchen here. So what is cooking?
Chai.
Chai?
Yeah.
Aha.
This farm is made up of 8 separate households.
So this is your son's house? Big. The boys get the big houses.
But all of them connect back to Masenda. It's an incredibly complicated web of relationships that's going to take some working out.
So... So, after you married, when did you have your first child? And is it very important for you to have a son? Okay, so I'm beginning to understand now. So because your son had died, he wouldn't bring a daughter-in-law here. And so that's when you decided you needed a Niom Bamboki. Have I understood that right?
Niom Bamboki, no. Haro kunyoro tano mana wege sacha. Pono wansa kutuno moka mana iku munyuri ache ibro mana we kirisi unyuri umumura.
In the polygamous system here, each wife looks after her own household. Masenda has sons and daughters-in-law through his other wives, but because Paulina's only son died, she's been left alone without any support as she gets older.
When you decided you wanted or you needed a Niom Bamboki, how did you meet Lillian?
Lillian, you know.
Then, Pauline, you decided to get a second Niom Bamboki, who is Faith.
Nikaona sasa huyu, pataja kusaidia huyu, inakuwa sita. Sama heri ni mwenyatea msaidisi mwingine.
So it sounds like Lillian and Faith are essentially replacement daughters-in-law, brought into the household to provide physical help and especially to bear sons, male heirs for Paulina. I can understand what Paulina gets out of this, but it's less clear what's in it for the younger women.
Oh, Faith, is this your room?
Yes.
Hi. Hello. Hello, little person.
So this is where you stay?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And who is this?
Robbie.
Robbie?
Yeah.
Hi, Robbie. And Faith, who is Robbie's father?
Anna Baba.
No father. Okay.
Like so many young Niom Bamboki brides, Faith was made to marry Paulina because she got pregnant out of wedlock. But I know this wasn't the case for Lillian, who's lived here as Paulina's wife for 11 years.
When you became
Pauline's Nyambomboki. What is the arrangement?
Ningombi disababisha. Wa wazazi ndio walikubaliana wakanilazimisha nikafunja hapa.
And how old were you when your parents arranged this marriage with Pauline?
19. Sikutaka, lakini heshima ya baba.
So Lillian, are you telling me that you didn't want to be a Nyambomboki?
Asikutaka kwa vile sasa venye wazazi unapewa wazazi heshima ikabidi nikakuja.
Because if I understand it right, if you had married a man, your parents would still have had a dowry for you. So why did they choose for you to marry a woman and not a man?
Sasa, wanasema, mwanaume angetoa zenye nilitoka. Unajua mimi nilitoka ng'ombe 14. Sasa ile ng'ombe venye ilikuja kwetu, mzazi akaniambia,
you have to continue the family line. So do you have children with Masena?
Apana.
No? Okay. So, okay. So how?
Sasa rafiki ndiye alizaa first born wangu anaitwa Sauro. Tena tukakutana na mwingine, mwenye alizaa Daniel. Ndio tumekanda yeye, amezaa Christine. Namiza Alice.
If you meet a nice lover, someone who looks after you, who doesn't just get you pregnant all the time, can you leave this family and start a proper relationship with him?
Unaona, itakuwa ni shida kuwatoa huko. So tunaona hata wakipindi wakipindi.
It's pretty shocking when you hear from a girl's mouth that she was, to all intents and purposes, sold. That a daughter here is a commodity. And in Lillian's case, she was worth more as a wife, if that's the right word, to another woman, than she was as a wife to a husband. And that she had no choice in that matter. These Nyambomboki relationships aren't sexual. Lillian is heterosexual. But if she were to ever fall in love with a man, she'd never be able to leave Paulina for a relationship with him. To me, that seems very sad. But perhaps that's just my Western romanticism.
So this one? So Baba.
Do you take the whole thing? No, you take the you have all this? No, really? Okay. So and then beans?
Beans.
Within this community, there are rigid roles for boys and girls.
There we are. We're doing a good job.
Sons never leave the family home. They provide daughters-in-law to help aging parents.
That's for you. Who are we missing?
And inherit their father's land.
So this boy? Yeah. There we go. That's for you.
Courier girls, on the other hand, must leave home when they marry to bear children for the husband's family.
Yeah? Here you are, little one. That's for you.
At the end of my first day on Masenda's farm, I'm left wondering whether there are any positives for the young Neon Bomboki brides. The Neon Bomboki system seems to be firmly rooted in this community. But there's another tradition here, which is even more entrenched. Since the time of their ancient ancestors, Kuria people have circumcised both boys and girls as an important rite of passage into adulthood. In this predominantly Christian area, the church is at the heart of current debate around female circumcision, also known as female genital mutilation. Since 2011, FGM has been illegal in Kenya. Lillian, like many women from her generation, has been circumcised.
The pastor talked about FGM today. What do you think the congregation, the men and the women that were there, thought of that message? So do you think that attitudes are starting to change?
Wamesema kwamba wamejaribu kuangalia makabila nyawa wajitailiwa watoto wao wako ma secondary ndio wanapita sana. Bado mtoto huyu hajatailiwa, bado mtoto huyu hajatailiwa. Ah, moja mimi ni haja. Yani inaisha pole pole. Zijesha kwa, lakini inaisha pole pole wanaona.
I'm here in Korea at the start of the boys' circumcision season, which usually lasts for 2 weeks and happens every other year.
Just to get this straight, the circumcision of boys is completely legal in Kenya, isn't it?
Completely.
And the circumcision of girls is now against the law.
It is illegal to circumcise a girl.
Although illegal, it's been reported that FGM still takes place in this community. Pete's been campaigning against female circumcision since 2001, and he's keen to show me just how deep-rooted it is in Kuria culture.
From the outside, it seems, you know, so simple. FGM's a brutal practice. It's mutilating and effectively abuse of a minor. It shouldn't happen. But it gets more complicated when you begin to understand the custom, the significance of that custom.
It is.
Circumcised? Oh, poor little things. It's at the right. You've got boys wearing kind of capes and bleeding.
We've come across a male circumcision procession. And as it's legal, it's being celebrated in a very public and noisy ceremony.
So can you tell me what has happened? Oh, these poor little boys. Oh, my goodness.
They have been circumcised. Eh?
They have been circumcised. Yeah. So did you do the circumcising?
Yeah.
Can you tell me the importance of this ceremony? Now they've become men. Okay. So did you go through this ceremony?
Yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
You look like It looked like the memories are coming flooding back.
I know, that sounds a bit scared, like to talk to the boys. I know where they're feeling right now.
Really? When it happened to you, is there a real pressure on you to be kind of as brave as possible?
Yeah, there's a lot of taunting before, like, please don't cry, don't cry, don't be a woman.
Did you cry?
No.
Didn't you?
Nobody's making fun of me. When you're circumcised, mm-hmm. you have to behave differently. Mm-hmm. You're a man, you should have responsibilities. And in the near future, get a wife, start your home, and just being a stand up on your 2 feet.
From what you were telling me about the huge importance, significance of circumcision for men, does that go some way into explaining why there are still girls being circumcised despite the fact that it's against the law?
The issue with FGM is about identity. And for very many Kuria people, like it would be men and women alike, they feel if there is no circumcision for men and FGM for girls, like they lose a bit of their identity.
Okay.
So that's creating some resistance.
Because boys are seen as more important in Korea culture, they're always circumcised a few days before the girls. So with the male circumcision season already underway, there's a very real possibility that Korea's girls will be next. The region's anti-FGM movement is out in force.
Susan Thomas, siku ya leo uko hapa kwa ajili gani?
Kwa ajili ya mama na FGM. No, to FGM.
The organizer of the rally is a Korea woman, Susan Matinde Thomas.
Was there a reason that you particularly wanted to do this very loud demonstration now?
Tuko na hasira sababu wasichana wetu wanakata uchungu sana. Wakati msichana amekatwa ana bleach, anatoka damu nyingi, wengine wanabaki hivyo ama wengine wanakataa kuzaa. Sababu tuko na vita nyingi sana. Watoto wetu wametulimia, watoto wetu wanakatwa, wanaacha shule. Sasa hiyo ndio maana tunangangana wasichana wetu wabaki wakiwa wazima.
Basi tunasema ya kwamba kwa nini unapinga utohara wa mtoto wa kike?
Inarudisha maendeleo nyuma.
Inarudisha maendeleo nyuma. Tunakubaliana nayo. Kama unakubaliana tohara ya mtoto wa kike inarudisha maendeleo, inua mikono yako juu.
We've heard that more efforts are being made by the authorities this year to clamp down on FGM. And police patrol vehicles are flanking Susan's campaign bus.
Can you tell me what you think about this procession? So were you cut?
Yeah, mimi nilikata, lakini wako wangu wawili sijakata, wako shuleni, wako university.
Is there anybody here who wants to be cut?
Kuna hapa group moja anataka kukata.
No one. And is that because of school?
Yeah.
From what I'm hearing, it seems that the law is working here, and this community really is buying into the change.
And so no girls in this village will be cut this season?
No one can.
How will you feel if you have a wife who is very strong, has had a good education?
I will feel happy.
You will be happy? If she remember, he said this. You were witnesses.
But Pete's been speaking to some young men who have a different take on things. And he's asked us to keep our camera at a distance so we don't draw attention to them.
Ladies who were telling me that the girls will not be cut in this village, is that true or not true?
Kuna vile watu wa hii, unajua hii campaign. If it will be happen,
yeah.
It will be done secretly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you know anyone in this village who maybe you think might be circumcised? Any girl?
There are many mm-hmm. in a number,
mm-hmm.
but We don't know.
How many?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Wow, okay. That was unexpected. It felt like, you know, everyone was very on message in this village. Everybody was really against it.
So now, I'm left wondering whether this community will act in accordance with the law or revert back to the tradition that has defined Kuria for centuries. It's 6 a.m. and I'm back with Lillian. And some of her Neon Bomboke friends. They're a close-knit group. We're heading to work on a farm an hour and a half's walk away. A journey they make almost every day.
No. No babies. They're too scary. Too much trouble.
I want to understand how Neon Bomboki women survive financially without a husband to help support their families.
So, Dorica, this one is bad.
This one is bad.
That one's bad, yes. Yeah. I'm taking that one out. But this one is good, yes?
Yeah.
Yeah, and this one is good.
Yeah.
They're quite confusing. How many people are you supporting on the money you earn?
Six.
Six people. So that's you, your four children?
And my five kids.
Your five kids?
Yeah.
Is there anyone else in the family that is also working to help you, to help you bring in money? No. So it's only you? So, as a Neon Bomboki, I think one of your main duties is to have children. Talk me through this. How do you go and find a man? I can...
Hey, you name my name for Kakabur?
Would you want your daughters to be Neon Bomboki? Why not?
Sina msaidishi wa kunisaidia watoto. Mtoto augue mimi huyo. Mtoto afukuze shuleni mimi huyo. Mtoto atafute kitu ya kula mimi huyo. Kila kitu ni mimi tu. Hiyo ndio shida.
If any of you could change the law, would you make the Neon Bomboki system illegal? You would. Would you? Really? Do you think it will change?
While cultural traditions are being challenged in Kuria, and there is a growing movement against Neon Bomboki, the current focus is on FGM. While the Kenyan government supports the circumcision of boys, even claiming it's helping in the fight against HIV, the illegal circumcision of girls has no medical benefit whatsoever. The opposite, in fact. It can be life-threatening. The practice of FGM can range from the removal of the clitoris to the most extreme procedure, which reduces the entrance to the vagina. It creates all kinds of horrific medical problems, sometimes resulting in death.
Susan!
I'm meeting up with Susan, who led the anti-FGM rally, to find out why she's prepared to put herself at risk in her fight to stop FGM.
Can you remember what that circumcision was like?
Like so many women, Susan's FGM has resulted in lifelong problems. After nearly dying from extreme blood loss, she was so mutilated that she had to have surgery. At least 200 million women and girls alive today across 30 countries have undergone female genital mutilation. Here in Kenya, numbers are slowly going down, but those most at risk are girls in poor, rural areas like Kuria. We've been traveling along this road almost every day, but this morning, there seems to be a lot more activity than usual. Samson Marua is in charge of our security.
Did you see that group of people up above the road?
Yes, I did.
And do you think that was a circumcision party?
Yes.
And do you think it was for a girl?
For girls, yeah.
What made you think that it was for girls?
You know, they wear different clothes, different with the boys.
Yeah.
So it was, I confirmed that she was a lady. She was two ladies.
So, Petey, do you think this is now basically the start of the female circumcision season?
Yeah.
Okay.
It really is shocking. Despite it being against the law, it looks like FGM is still here. As we reach the outskirts of a small town, we notice lots of young girls being rushed around on motorbikes. The atmosphere feels very tense.
So I am trying to understand why circumcision for girls is so important.
Samson's warned us to be careful and to keep our camera discreet.
I don't know whether there is someone, whether I can talk to you as young men, or if there are any women that I can talk to. Can you explain to me why you will even break the law to do this because it's so important for your custom?
Wanasema msichana mwenye hajatairiwa kindly anakuaga ni muhot yani kumsubua yani nakuaga ni vigumu sana yani aliziki yani kuliziki na kwa ni vigumu sana. Yeah. Sasa ndio maana unaona unafuatilia fuatilia lakini government yenyewe inapiga vita lakini vile naona bado hiyo vitu lazima itaendelea tu. Kwa sababu vijana wa hapa kwetu wamekuangali sana. Yaani
wamejipanga.
Wamejipanga.
Ona naje vile wameanza kuwa ma warriors
hapa. Warriors eh?
Yeah.
Yaani mbona?
Yeah.
So singing.
Okay. Samson 20. Yeah. Let's go. Let's go.
Samson.
Let's go Samson pale. Yeah. Ah, twende.
Huko
hivyo.
From what those young men told me, FGM's much more than a rite of passage. It sounds like it's about men controlling women's sexuality. And it looks like the change in the law has simply driven FGM underground.
That place is completely guarded. Trevi is willing to go to war about it.
They're willing to go to war
to let FGM continue.
I think it's good to get police and then they give us a backup.
Okay.
We've driven to the local Korea East police station.
Should I come with you or?
Yes.
Yes?
Yeah. Okay.
But they've asked us not to film inside the building. Tensions are running so high, the local police chief has said we should leave the area.
Why is he asking us to be escorted out of town by a police car?
He said it could be very dangerous,
right.
And he doesn't want a confrontation with the community.
Right.
They would confront the police, and the police would have to shoot back. He was desperate to avoid that situation. They've decided not to confront the community, to ignore the law.
Clearly, attitudes to FGM are changing, but it is going to take time. It's really complicated. Oh, I'm sorry. Can you stop? Just for 2 minutes.
Pete's been campaigning against FGM for years. So what we've witnessed today is particularly hard on him.
I felt very powerless. And I felt like we haven't changed at all. I just like a step back.
Yeah.
Oh, I can completely understand why for you it's so frustrating and...
It's ingrained, you know, you're born and, like, you're told this is a way of life.
Mm.
But it's just also very wrong that, like, in 2016, there's so much information available to us.
I'm meeting the Deputy County Commissioner for Courier West, Sebastian Ockering, to find out what his department is doing to tackle FGM.
As a security team in Courier West, what did we do? We made arrangements to remove the circumcisers from the society.
But not all of them?
Of course, we cannot remove all
no.
of them. So we have made an attempt to remove the circumcisers. We have made an attempt to arrest the elders who propagate FGM.
Mm-hmm.
These things persist for commercial reasons.
Commercial reasons?
Commercial reasons.
Why do you say that?
I say that because the elders are very keen on this rite of passage
mm-hmm.
because they make money out of it.
How?
For every girl circumcised, they charge 1,000 Kenya shillings.
Wow.
The elders charge 1,000. So if you have 3,000 girls, that
yeah.
is a whopping 3 million shillings within 1 month. The elders make the families, the poor families, believe that if they circumcise their girl
yeah.
at age 12 to 14, they are able to marry her off and get 10 head of cattle. The existence of the Council of Elders
right.
makes this thing persist.
Okay.
It's the clan elders who protect Courier culture and traditions. And it seems that it's also the elders who are perpetuating FGM. Pete's persuaded a local council of elders to meet us.
Oh my goodness, look at this!
This is a welcoming party.
Oh my word!
This welcoming ceremony is part of Courier's ancient religion, which is ruled over by their god, Eressa.
It's a marriage proposal.
And according to his believers, Eressa has the power to curse those who are not circumcised or stand in his way.
I wanted to ask you about the role of women in Korea society. So, for example, we have the Council of Elders here, and they are all men. I mean, do you think women are wise enough to be consulted on everyday life to ask their advice in the way that people ask you?
They cannot keep secrets.
Who?
The women.
The women. Okay, so
if
you...
If we involve them
mm-hmm.
and they know what we are doing, when they go to fetch water or anywhere, they'll tell others.
So who protects the women?
She was bought. That's why you pay the dowry.
It is true.
Now we are getting a problem. The government is trying to force the Koreans that they should only circumcise boys.
Mm-hmm.
They have copied the Western culture.
Right.
The Western culture is not the same as the African culture.
Mm-hmm.
So it becomes difficult. It becomes now a tug of war.
From what I believe, you agreed with the district officer that you would ask your gods whether to do female circumcision this year, this
yes.
season,
yeah.
or not. Are you able to tell me what your god told you?
We said that we are not going to circumcise girls.
Mm-hmm.
Our God will kill us.
na anaweza kubani unaweza kuhamona akole vitu vibebe kukipara kino bantu boro kuona.
The elders hold enormous sway over their community and how it works, and are still clearly supporting FGM. Since the police are conflicted about how to deal with it, it seems to me that one of the few people actually taking a stand is anti-FGM campaigner Susan Thomas. Since the season began, she's been rescuing girls at risk of circumcision and taking them to a safe house. Tonight, we're meeting her as she responds to another call for help. What Susan's about to do is very dangerous. So she's paid for an armed police guard to be with her tonight. So we need to go?
Yeah.
Okay. Is the problem that her parents want her to be circumcised?
So the mother doesn't want her to be cut.
Right. But other members of the family do?
The father does.
The father does. So, Susan, this must be a huge risk for the mother as well when her husband finds out what she's done. Have you ever done this before, Peter?
No, this is the first time. There's a lot of anxiety because so many things that could go wrong, but here they come.
They're coming, okay. Now, for obvious reasons, we will not be identifying the girl.
Thank you.
We're returning to the village we visited early on for Susan's anti-FGM rally, where everyone told us they were against female circumcision. Michael Mahodji is on the Council of Elders, and he's got something to tell us.
Lakini kitu kibaya walishika wazee. Sasa ile mse wetu akakasirika, akasema tuendele na kazi. Yes.
And have the police tried to stop you?
How is? Ireza tawaua.
So how many girls were circumcised at your place last night?
350.
In one night?
Yeah.
Kwa sababu kuacha mila ni mtu, ni mtumwa. Tukiacha hilo mila yetu, itasemekana sisi ni watumwa.
Do you do the circumcising of the girls, or is it somebody else who comes in to do them?
Fundamentally, nyingine ni wa mama. Wa mama ndio wanafanya hivyo. Ndio wameamua wafanye hivyo.
And because they are being, because these circumcisions are happening right by your house, and because you're on the Council of Elders, does that mean that you get paid for these circumcisions?
Yes. Yes.
How much?
500.
500 per girl?
Why?
For one girl.
For one girl.
500 for one girl.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Alright. Are they just from this village or do they come in from other villages as well?
Kila sehemu ya Korea. Wanataili kila sehemu ya Korea.
I can't quite find the words to describe how I feel after that conversation with Mahodji, who was so matter-of-fact and worse, unashamed. It probably shouldn't surprise and shock me, but it does. The realization that the village where so many people told me early on during my time here that they wouldn't cut their girls has just circumcised 350 in one night. It's incredibly difficult to come to terms with. The only positive in all this is that the circumcision season is nearly over. Those girls that escaped being cut are free of the risk of FGM for another 2 years. Before I leave Korea, I want to say goodbye to wonderful Lillian. I've been invited to join her and some of her Neon Bomboki friends at a baby naming ceremony, a way of welcoming a new child to the community. Lillian and many women like her may have had to endure FGM and may be the unwilling victims of woman-to-woman marriage. But they also seem determined to strive for a better future.
Would you like your daughters, Christine and Alice, to have a different sort of life from yours? What is your ambition for them? This is clearly such a complex time in Korea society. It really does feel like it is at a time of change. when there are people like the fabulously brave Susan going out on the streets and talking to people. Women like Lillian, who will talk about their experiences and absolutely categorically say, my girls are not going to be circumcised. There is definitely a movement. And I really get the feeling it's gathering momentum. What is holding it back, without question, are the old men, is the patriarchy. But anyone who can laugh when life is as tough as theirs deserves absolute, ultimate respect. These aren't women standing with their hands out asking for help. These are women who are standing upright and saying, we are trying to change things. If you can help us, join us. But we're going to do this. We're going to do it on our own.
Thank you.
Next time, I'm in Israel.
Please do not pass through our neighborhood in immodest clothes.
Where I struggle to access the ultra-Orthodox Haredim.
Oh, I don't know whether we're...
Stop filming.
An intensely private people. Who must adhere to strict religious laws.